Building trust with luxury consumers. Now this is Thoughtful. Hello, I'm Trevor Lai in Shanghai. In recent episodes of Thoughtful China, we've discussed the growing sophistication of China's luxury goods market and even looked specifically at what the next generation of luxury consumers will expect from brands. On today's show, we're giving you an in-depth look at the opportunities in the market for niche, high-end brands. I'm joined today by Loree Rodkin, an American jewelry designer based in Los Angeles, who is just entering the Chinese market. We're in her showroom in Shanghai today, along with Ricardo Ferrer, CEO of Asian Horizon China, who is helping Ms. Rodkin and other niche luxury brands enter the Chinese market, largely through e-commerce. Loree, Ricardo, thanks for being on our show today. Loree, you're one of the most celebrated designers in the US today. You designed the jewelry for Michelle Obama during the inaugural ceremony, which is now permanently deposited at the Smithsonian Institute. And you've also had a guest and customer list, which reads like a who's who of Hollywood, from Elton John to Rihanna to Madonna and Elizabeth Taylor. Can you talk to us a little bit about your first celebrity customers?
You know, I got so lucky because Elizabeth Taylor was my first client. A friend had bought her a piece of my jewelry, and Elizabeth called me one day. She goes, "Honey, it's Elizabeth. I'm coming over. I'm in my pajamas. I hope you don't mind." And we sat on the floor in my house and played jewelry. And she used to do, "Let's do the blues," or "Let's do the lilacs today." And she would shop in color.
Amazing. And for a first time, at that point, you were at the beginning of your design career, I presume?
Very beginning.
And what was that like to be thrown headfirst into the celebrity world of Hollywood right away?
Well, I was coming from Hollywood. I managed Brad Pitt and Robert Downey and Sarah Jessica Parker. So I was a little bit jaded. But still, I was sitting on the floor going, "Oh my God, Elizabeth Taylor is in my living room in her pajamas."
And this was Brad Pitt around the Thelma and Louise?
I put Brad and Thelma and Louise, sorry.
Exactly. And so what do you think about now looking back at their careers, and especially Robert Downey Jr. now that he's had a complete resurgence? Do you feel like you're still a part of that, you know, engine, having started with them 30 years ago, 20, 30 years ago?
Well, perversely, I call my jewelry the House of Downey because he's responsible for me designing jewelry. Because I used to make jewelry late at night, so I would keep myself awake because I would rescue Robert from where he was misbehaving. Because if I didn't, he didn't show up for work.
And so celebrity culture and style has been part of your DNA from a design standpoint for decades. But some of our viewers may also be surprised to know that the Eagles song Hotel California was written about you. Is that correct?
Yes, that's true. I mean, you live with a songwriter and they write about real life. Don Henley and I lived together at the time that he was writing that album, so a lot of our conversations in the car went into that album.
So tell me, share a couple of stories, I guess, with our viewers about some of the most memorable experiences you had prior to coming to China.
Gosh, you know, there was a time that Steven Tyler came up to me at a concert, looked at my diamond skull ring and sucked it off my finger, said, "I guess you have to sell it to me now." That was one. Madonna went on the radio and said the only thing she wanted for her birthday was my jewelry. I mean, those were moments that were jaw-dropping. And the time the White House called me and asked if I would be interested in designing jewelry for, I thought I was being punked.
And now switching to your time in China, I mean, obviously you've been spoiled in a lot of senses by, you know, clients that come up to you when normally brands probably, you know, beg or work really hard to get their attention. Are you coming here with a perhaps more humble approach to launching the brand and thinking that, or do you expect the same type of treatment here?
Oh God, you know, I don't think I've ever expected anything. I feel so blessed where I am in my career. I've never had a strategy. I've never had a 5-minute plan, let alone a 5-year plan. So I'm coming to China really because Ricardo and my friend Carmen Busquets from Net-a-Porter encouraged me to come to China. It's a place I wanted to visit. It's a, you know, place I think that my jewelry will do really well. It's all new.
And let's talk about your jewelry specifically, because you have a very distinctive style. Some of it is very medieval in its tone, and as you mentioned, the skull ring, you know, that was in Steven Tyler's mouth. You know, can you talk about your inspiration and where you draw that from? Where is it from film, because you spend so much time in Hollywood and in that world, or is it from books, or is it from mythology?
You know, I've always collected medieval and Gothic art. So back in the day, when I was designing houses, I had Art Nouveau and very ornamental furniture. So for me, the idea of anything highly structured and ornate was really appealing, and that's how it started. I had a suit of armor in my living room, and I used to play with it, and I thought, God, that's so interesting. And I'm a rock chick, and I want something unique for jewelry, which didn't exist.
Well, let's take a minute and actually look at some of your jewelry right now.
That's a cute. These are the Mrs. Obama earrings. They're in the White House, that I did for the White House, that are in the Smithsonian. And that ring I did for Madonna.
Wow.
And I did those earrings for Cher. Actually, both Madonna and Cher came to me for my designs. And in Cher's case, she was like, I want them longer. Madonna was like, I need it this color. Mm-hmm. And you know, it was for her campaign. It was her billboard and for her tour. Oh, okay. So it was really for things I'd already,
yeah, for me. and what about Mrs. Obama? Can you talk about that?
They gave me her measurement from her ear to her shoulder, mm-hmm. and said that they wanted something of my design, not as fashion forward as my normal. Mm-hmm. And so I just designed what I liked.
So Ricardo, your role in bringing Loree and her brand to China is really to help launch a new type of luxury jewelry brand in what is growing to be one of the most important luxury markets in the world. Can you talk about the timing and your thought process when you were looking at Loree and her brand, obviously established in Hollywood, but perhaps in China it is a new startup type of project?
The idea comes because I've been in China for 20 years, and I've actually had the chance and the luck of seeing how this country has changed. One of the things that I've always been looking at is the luxury sector and how it has changed amazingly and at a speed that you have not seen anywhere else in the world, actually. So I saw when Louis Vuitton started coming, or all the big brands came here to China, then I saw how people were really saving and trying to buy these sort of brands to maybe differentiate themselves. And I've also seen how the Chinese customer has changed to an amazingly sophisticated customer that has traveled, that has studied abroad, that has been here and there. And we were seeing that they really do not need so much those big logos. And now what they want is a product that connects with them. A product that I always say that Loree Rodkin product has a soul. That product is part of her. It's not part of a marketing team. So that's the reason with my partner, with Carmen Busquets, we were thinking to bring here a brand that was very special and very different. And we think Loree Rodkin is absolutely special and absolutely different.
And on that note, I know that you've already attracted a lot of media attention, obviously, and I think that has to do with your pedigree and your very rich experiences. At the same time, one of the lessons that we've learned and talked about a lot on our show is how brands really have to adapt themselves to the Chinese market, to the tastes of the Chinese consumers. What is it, if anything, that you think you'll need to change in terms of the design or how you approach communicating the brand in China that would be different than what you've done in Hollywood?
Well, I think the interesting thing is the Chinese market is growing into a more adventurous spirit in things that they acquire. And it no longer is necessary for them to do logos, to do Chanel, Gucci. And I think that it will be a unique experience for me, really meeting the client and seeing what it is they prefer. So far globally, the markets have adapted to my style. And I'm adventurous, so I'm open to change and seeing what it is that really appeals, whether it's scale or color.
And you obviously have already launched the brand in Japan and Russia. And I believe you also had Zhang Ziyi and the Coldplay video recently also incorporated some of your jewelry. So you have started to really introduce the Chinese audience, a lot of whom raved about that her involvement in that video. You've started to introduce your designs. Is there a strategy, Ricardo, over the next 6 months to introduce the brand in a larger way into the Chinese celebrity circles?
At this moment, we are doing it. We are much more interested in word of mouth. So for example, tomorrow we're doing an event which where people, clients and KOLs will be meeting Loree Rodkin. So she'll be together with Miss China with a very selected group of people, because what we are not going to compete is with the big boys, with the big brands. First, because that's not where we want to play, and that's not who Loree is. So we're gonna have a strategy that is targeted at the clients that will be willing to buy her products. So we are certainly changing the communication strategy. We are very heavy on social media. Loree, of course, has already her Weixin, she has her Weibo, she has her website translated to Chinese, and she's already starting to have events here in China. So I think we've doing a pretty good adaptation to the Chinese market.
And talking about Weibo and Weixin, obviously your online sales component is an integral part of your sales strategy in China. Can you talk about that?
There is two reasons that we are focusing on the sales online. The first reason is that practicality. We will never cover the whole of China with a retail strategy. So that's a very, let's say, important issue. Another issue is that my partner, Carmen Busquets, she is the co-founder. She started Net-a-Porter. Probably she's the guru of luxury on the internet. So why not use the knowledge of, I would say, the number one person in the world in this type of in this type of e-commerce, in this type of selling? And another thing that is important for us is that people talk about the experience in the shops. And I think that's a little bit overrated. I think that the customer that wants to buy Loree Rodkin's products might like to come maybe to a showroom and to meet her, but a shop in a big street where the salespeople, that's not an experience that he's looking for. His life is very busy with other things, and Loree Rodkin is something, it's a product that he likes, but he does not really care about if a salesperson looks at him admiringly.
Right, and also from a business standpoint, as you mentioned, renting that prime real estate in the middle of a Huaihai Road, for example, doesn't make a lot of sense, perhaps, for a brand that has specific customers, a specific profile, one that is probably seeking you out, you know, less so than just walking down a busy street and just happens to wander in. So really, your walk-in customer, you know, is probably very small, if at all, compared to your existing clientele or the word-of-mouth clientele. But interestingly enough, as pragmatic as that sounds, there's also the flip side of that, which is if you're selling pieces that are tens of thousands of RMB, there's a huge trust aspect to purchasing luxury online. How do you intend to deal with that?
We've done it, first of all, making very clear the connection between Loree Rodkin and the Loree Rodkin China that we are here. So our website is exactly the same as the US. And in all our communication, you can see that we are together. That we were together as a team. So people have really no doubt that we are the actual distribution channel for Loree Rodkin. This is one of the main points. Another point is that we are not purely online. We have a showroom here. So we tell our customers, you can buy and pay online, and you can come and pick it up. And depending on who it is, we might even deliver it to him through some special channel personally. So we are treating a special market in a special way.
And for the viewers who haven't had a chance to see the beautiful property where we're sitting right now, can you talk a little bit about its discovery process and how you designed this environment?
Actually, I'm very lucky. My mother-in-law is Chinese, and she's from Shanghai. She left a few years ago to Hong Kong, but she knows very well how luxury used to be here in China. So she was telling me, this is the area that the Chinese people feel it's nice and has that feeling of luxury of the 1930s. And also, she told me Lane House would be a place that people would be comfortable to be. As you were saying very well, having a shop on the street makes no sense. Here, it's a place where we can communicate with our clients, we can do events, we can have people like you coming here, and people, as we were saying, if they want to buy, we're very happy if they come to pick it up here.
Now, Loree, what is something that you perhaps had wondered or thought, a perception you had of China, that was completely dispelled once you arrived here and spent some time here?
Oh God, I mean, the first thing I worried about was being knocked off in China, which is what you hear. But I just love this place culturally, and I love the way it looks. I love, it's a very Zen place for me. So it's all an adventure for me. I don't know enough yet, I plan to find out.
Do you think that after spending more time here, some of the Chinese influences might make their way into your design?
Absolutely. I'm so influenced every time I travel. Anything architecturally, it ends up as a piece in my jewelry. So I'm sure a temple or the edge of a building or the courtyard in the hotel I'm staying in will end up as a bracelet.
And even though you don't have a 5-minute plan or, you know, a 5-week plan, what in your mind's eye do you envision China and the Chinese customer being like after interacting with your brand? Do you see them as being an integral part of your global customer base? Is this an experiment? Is this, you know, hopefully a big part of your global brand plan?
I'd say my life was an experiment. I'm hoping that this is an integral part because it's certainly a place I'd like to spend time. I think that the market is open now to more fashion-forward thinking, so I'll be curious to see.
Let's take a break to hear from our sponsor. Then we'll be back to hear more from Loree Rodkin and Ricardo Ferrer.
Thoughtful China 这个它里面的这个节目的内容也是十分之丰富。
Welcome back. And Ricardo, what's the number one challenge you think you'll be facing in terms of building a brand here that has a rich heritage and, you know, some wonderful design, you know, advantages, but at the same time is going to be starting from, as you mentioned, a position of an upstart, a startup here?
The biggest is probably going to be speed. We'd probably like to be growing faster than we will be growing. But this is a challenge that we know from the beginning. We are very keen on keeping all the distribution and communications channels very clear and very controlled. We want Loree to be present here. We don't want it to be a marketing plot. We are trying to transmit the soul of a person to the client. So that does not work with big billboards and things like this. And again, we are focusing a very targeted part of the clientele, maybe 3% of the Chinese population. So we think at the beginning is a bit tougher. We cannot do the big TV. It makes no sense, as you said very well. But this is the path that if we follow it, that's the path of growth that we're going to have. So a bit of patience, but we're already actually very happy the way it's going.
So I also understand that a big part of your trust strategy, trust building strategy, is a so-called trust seal on trustlux.com. But as a new brand, how do you build trust in the seal concept?
The thing of the seal actually comes from a situation in the market. When you read all the studies that you have from McKinsey, from Bain, you find that the number one reason that people are not buying online is a trust issue, which is logical with what has happened here before in China. So we have seen that there is a place in the market for somebody trying to help the Chinese consumer to be able to find the brands that they are looking for without worrying that in the process something might happen. And we have also seen that Western brands that want to come to China, they are afraid. So they need a tool that helps them when they come to China be able to communicate directly with their consumer without worrying. The way we've done the trust seal, this trust seal is added to the website, like you can see in Loree Rodkin's website now. When people click in that trust seal, it goes to our website where there's a certificate that certifies that this is the real website of Loree Rodkin. And this way we are filling a void. It's a demand that we have seen that was there, and we are covering up that demand. Another thing that it's important for us, in this website, you can see myself and Carmen Busquets. Carmen Busquets is a person that everybody knows, that she sold Net-a-Porter as a co-founder at a valuation of more than £500 million. So people are very aware that she's not out there to confuse people or to cheat on people. So we think that she's a figure in the luxury world that people trust. People know that she's not doing it for nothing more than the love of helping the brands that she has in her heart, like Loree's brand. So there's really no reason that that trust seal would not be good for the Chinese consumer. How it's going to grow, we are finding it quite amazing. We've started the strategy of starting to communicate with the brands the existence of this seal, and the response has been quite amazing. What we thought was going to happen, which is a big demand for the Western brands to come to China in a safe way and tools to help them, is a demand that is there, and we are actually seeing it happening.
So Loree, a big part of your success in the West has been your celebrity fans, your celebrity clients. Are you planning to use a lot of key opinion leaders and celebrities through social media and other events and campaigns here in China?
I'm hoping to. I mean, I think I'm very lucky. The celebrities sought me out in my jewelry. I'm hoping that I have the same dramatic effect here in China. You know, I design jewelry for myself, and I've been fortunate that it has appealed to so many people. We'll see.
Loree, Ricardo, thanks for being on Thoughtful China.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Trevor.
That wraps it up for today. Be sure to subscribe to us on Youku, Tudou, and YouTube. You can also follow us on Weibo, WeChat, and Twitter, and join our LinkedIn group. See you again.